is. In this chapter 5. When you find it, you would stand on your feet. And there are a couple of verses I want us to look at today. Chapter 5 of Amos. Reading from the English Standard Version. Beginning at verse number 14. Are you there?
Amen.
Amen. And it reads, seek good and not evil, that you may live. Seek good and not evil, that you may live. And so the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you, as you have said. Hate evil. And love good, and establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. Flip down, and let's go over to verse number 18. Woe to you who desire the day of the Lord. Why would you have the day of the Lord? It is darkness, not light, as if a man fled from a lion and a bear met him, or went into the house and leaned his hand against the wall and a serpent bit him. Is not the day of the Lord darkness? And not light and gloom with no brightness in it. I despise your feasts. I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them.
Oh, wow.
And the peace offerings of your fatted animals, I will not look upon them. Take away from me the noise of your songs, the melody of your harps, I will not listen. But let justice roll down like waters. And righteousness like an ever-flowing stream.
Thank you, God.
This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I want to talk from the thought just a few moments. When it's too big for us. When it's too big for us. By way of history, Africans started arriving on the shores of North America in 1619. That was about a year or so, actually, before the Mayflower. We'll talk about that at another time. But we do need to understand that the ships that transported Africans did not just transport Africans, but there were also some poor Europeans.
That's right.
Are y'all here? That were transported as indentured servants. And it was supposed to be for them when they completed their service, however unpleasant it might have been, that they would be free to pursue their lives. However, those of us of African descent were gradually forced to give our life for service. In other words, slavery. Now, I'm gonna go quick. Because we Africans were not British citizens, we were then considered outsiders. And by 1614, There were laws that were establishing the principle of lifetime servitude for the outsiders, the Africans. That in itself was the institution or the beginning of the institution of slavery. And it seems entirely fair based on what we know historically. It seems entirely fair to say that American culture was foundationally based on very two different conflicting systems. Uh-huh. One was the relentless removal of Native Americans. That's number one. That was the first system. And so for anyone to say that this country was built on Anglo-Saxon forefathers is a lie. Because they didn't found it. They found it by luck. But they didn't found it. You get what I'm saying? They stumbled across this land thinking it was India. And that is why Native Americans are named Indians, because of the accident. Are y'all here? Yeah. Of finding this land. So the first thing they had to do to make it appear as if they were the first was to just annihilate the native and indigenous people. And then the second system was the systematic exploitation of slave labor. While at the very same time and later on, freedom and democracy were established for some, it was being wrenched for others. In other words, from the very outset, this country was based on institutionalized oppression. I'm just trying to build where I'm trying to go. And so that we understand the framework and the frame of mind that some of us live with in today's society. We deal with a history of systemic oppression, a history of systemic slavery. So for us to look at the principles that were built into the very fabric of our American society and the fabric of our system of economics, when you ask us, we answer based on our historical context as well as our current status. Don't ask me if you don't want to know, because I don't just speak for me, but I speak for every person in my, hello somebody, in my culture. I speak for every person that is a part of the history of our people. And as I've been thinking about all that has been taking place in these past few years, and I do know that much of it is a response of Black Lives Matter. Right. Yeah. Right. You do know that, right? Yeah. And that much of it is a response to Black Lives Matter. And maybe we took it overboard just a bit, but here it is. When you recognize that all other lives mattered before, we cannot say that we overworked Black Lives Matter, because we know in the country Black Lives did not matter. Are you here? So the response is nothing more than a revelation that the forces of racism continue to sink deep in the roots of the society, and in light of these multiple interlocking racist-based systems in place, from housing to education, to law enforcement, to healthcare, to banking, even to grocery stores. Employment practices. Today, as a result of what we have seen and a result of what we have experienced as a people, many of us are frustrated. We're frustrated around the country. People are tired, people are disgusted, people are fed up, people are angry. But it didn't just get this way. Because the fact of the matter is, racism has not changed at the core. As a matter of fact, it never changed. Even with the great advances that we received as a result of the civil rights movement, guess what? It just quieted people down. But it didn't really change what was in them. Are y'all in the house? It hasn't changed. It only changed at the surface. So that we've got different methods. And we've got some different faces. But the leaves still sway the same because the root is the same.
Amen.
The fact of the matter is, white privilege exists. And it still rules. There can be a white person who has nothing. And you have triple the amount they have. But they still are in a better position than you because the color of their skin. Now y'all know that's fact. Y'all know that's the truth. White privilege still rules. And we are left holding the short end of the stick. And you can ask anyone and they'll tell you the same thing. And those that are caught in the paradox of some type of pseudo reality who don't understand what it really means to be black even though their skin is black, they will let you know that there's only a certain amount of access you will have even with your credentials. So there's a reality that we deal with when we're watching all that's going on in this country. We still have to deal with the bitter reality that thousands of innocent people were raped, shot in prison, systematically disenfranchised, and less important than the suggestion that a single white person might be complicit in a racist system. I'm trying to get to Amos. I'm going to get to Amos and then we out. This is the country we live in. The country where millions of black lives are valued less than a single white person's hurt feelings. This is the country in which we live, when blacks can be totally ignored, and other persons of minorities who can be excluded, who can be discounted and disenfranchised, and no problem. Black people thinking as a group are talking and living in a racist system. White people thinking as individuals refuse to talk about I and racist in the same sentence to protect their own individual personal goodness. And in doing so, trying to reject and or deny that racism exists. And so what happens is when you start arguing about personal non-racism, you miss the point. Because despite what things look like and despite what even happened in Charlottesville, people are dying not because individuals are racist per se, but because individuals are helping support a racist system by wanting to protect their own non-racist beliefs. I said that people are dying not just because of racism, but because of individuals who are supporting a racist system. And may be saying they're not racist, but are still supporting. Are you seeing what I'm saying? Still supporting a racist system. We see it. We see it. There has never been a question about whether white lives matter. When the white Spaniards arrived on these shores in their armored helmets, and they would force Indians to carry them on their backs until they collapsed, riding humans as if they were mules or horses, it was obvious that white lives matter. I'm going to get to Amos, I promise you. When 400 years, white slave ship brought loads of African slaves to our shores in chains and stripped them naked and sold them at auction in a public square of towns and cities, sold to slave owners who worked them to death and flogged them and raped them and murdered them. It was obvious whose lives mattered. And so now as we go through the 20th century and apartheid and segregated schools and segregated voting places, we're still fighting now. I just saw the thing that Reverend Barber put up about the meetings that are going to take place this week. There's a meeting this week, I think it's Tuesday night. If it's not Tuesday, it's Thursday at the community college about the rezoning and the redistricting and trying to desegregate. Desegregate in 2017, trying to desegregate our voting practices and the zones in which we vote. Because we recognize that zoning was done with the intention of segregating our district. somebody. And let me just give you a little heads up, because yes, it's a wonderful thing when we've got an area where people want to invest in education for some by putting up academies and putting up all of these wonderful schools. But you do remember initially when the first Halifax Academy was established out where it is, you do know that was not intended for us. Halifax Academy was the alternative. That was an aid to sustain segregation. I wish y'all would hear the truth in here. And so while we're popping up all these new schools all over town, you better believe that there's still somebody in the system who's trying to sustain segregation. Now, the only reason some of us are in there is because they will not get the funding and they will not get the certification if there are no brown faces in the classroom. I'm going to get to Amos and then we out of here. And y'all pray I don't fail. Here it is, here it is, here it is. And so who matters? See, all of that, this little stuff we see, is just a part and a pattern of a bigger systemic racism. And it's eating at the heart of this country. In every sphere of life, white people are treated differently than people of color. And now, because of who we have as the leader of the free world, they feel that they are free to finally do what they've been wanting to do. Because they know he will not address it. Y'all ain't hear what I'm saying? They know he will not call it out because of his associations and because of some of his funding sources. I wish you would hear me. See, when they buy you, you can't speak out. When you're a part of it, you can't address it. Hello, somebody. When you are one of them, you cannot come out from among. Y'all ain't hear what I'm saying. And so now they're doing all they had been wanting to do. And they feel it's valid because of the leader who spent a lot of time in those areas of the country while he was campaigning. I'm almost where y'all want me to be. Here is the thing with all of this oppression, with the systemic racism, with the disenfranchisement, and with all of these things, segregation and all of the things that trickle and the byproducts of this evil and hatred at its root. The question becomes, does God really care? Because if he cared, he would have acted by now, surely. Does God really care? Does he see? Does he hear? Does he feel? And does he, if I was in the world, I'd say, so does he give up? Because sometimes you want to know, God, do you see what's going on? Do you see that we have been struggling over 400 years? And even though the slaves were freed in 1863, it was not because they wanted slavery to end, but it was because that was the better thing to do, so that the nation would not be destroyed as a result of the fight against slavery. Please understand, Abraham Lincoln did not want to free the slaves. And we walk around making Abraham Lincoln a hero to Negroes. He was not interested in abolishing slavery. He thought he was forced to do it because he understood the price that would be paid in this country if he did not. So does God care? Does he see this? And if he sees it, why does he let it continue? Why does he let this race thing continue? Well, for one, he's trying to give us an opportunity to get it right before the day of the Lord. And this is what Amos has the heads up on. Because the warning is, you think the day of the Lord is going to be a great day. You think it's going to be a bright and happy and and sunny day. But the Lord says the day of the Lord will not be a light day, but there will be darkness, and there will be judgment. And so, you want to know, does God see? Yes, he sees. Yes, he knows. Yes, he hears. Yes, he feels. But he's trying to get us to understand that grace does run out. How do we fight this? Brothers, how do we fight this? Sisters, how do we fight it? For one thing, we've got to understand that no matter how bad we are and how big we are, it's still too big for us by ourselves. We can't do it in our own strength. We can't do it in our own power. We can't do it in our own might. It's too big for us. We're in a war that's really too big for us. And it started before us. And so what I have to do then, because I recognize that it's too big for me, I have to consciously release things into the hands of the Lord. Things that have happened to us as a people are much larger than us. Even though we've made some great advancements because of the commitment of people who insisted that we be served the same rights and the same justice that every citizen in the country should have, so that we can witness that things are still not where they ought to be, but they are better than they used to be in some instances. But even still, it's too big for us. And with all of the efforts and with all of the commitment and with all of the rallies and with all of the marching and fighting for equality and justice, there are some things that we must turn over to the hands of the Lord because it is still too big for us. How do we come up against such an arrogant nation which acts, who the actions done in this manner they feel they can justify? How can we come up against a nation that is rooted in systemic slavery and oppression? How can we do it? Well, we cannot do it without God. We cannot do it without his help, and we cannot do it without his hand. Are y'all in the house? We already have our perception. We already know contextually based on our reality. And so in that, we must understand that there are some things that we just cannot do. We share in the pain of slavery. And even after slavery, laws were still passed to eat away at our freedom. You do know, blessed versus Ferguson, right? Separate but equal became the law of the land. Some of you remember the lynchings that went on. We have a unique history as African Americans, and whether the facts support anything, there is a perception for us of injustice in the land despite what the record is, and that perception is based on our relative truth, and that awakens the consciousness because that in itself shows us it is bigger than us. Whenever we go into the courtroom, we get scared. Even if it's for something minor. Because in our mind, we have the perceived notion that the system does not work for us. Whenever we get pulled over, we get nervous. Hello, somebody. I got pulled over while I was in Winston-Salem at the Women's Convention last month. And I knew why I had gotten pulled over. I just didn't act like I knew. I knew that my tag, my sticker had expired. And so I was saying, well, you know what, I'm going to go ahead to Winston-Salem because I just got back. I said, hopefully I'll get to Winston-Salem. Everything will be all right. As soon as I get back, I'll go ahead and get my sticker. Well, lo and behold, you know what happens. I went speeding on my way from the convention center, car full of preachers, going to get something to eat in between services. And I saw the man at the light coming up. And I said, Lord Jesus, he's going to get behind me. And of course, he got behind me. So I pulled off just like everybody else going the speed limit. And next thing you know, boo! And I knew what he was probably pulling me over for. And I still got nervous. Because I understand, based on the history, previous history, and recent history, that sometimes a routine stop can end in death. Especially for African-American males. So as soon as he got to the car, I immediately put my hand, both hands on the steering wheel. I let my window down. I said, officer, what's the problem? He says, well, I pulled you over because your tag is expired. I said, what?
I didn't lie. I didn't say I didn't know that. I just said, what? Expired? Yeah, you have a copy of your license and your registration? I said, yes, I do. I said, however, it's in my armrest here. I just want to get it. He said, go right ahead. You're fine. You're fine. Now, he was more laid back than I was. I was tense and defensive. Because I didn't know what kind of shift was going to take place in the middle of this night. I followed directions as they said. He said, yes, you're fine. He went back. He said, where are y'all from? I said, we're from Weldon. Long way from here. He says, man, he says, well, I don't want to do this. I said, because then you probably have to come all the way back to Winston-Salem if you have to go to court. He says, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to just give you this warning and let you slide. He said, when you get back, make sure that you get your sticker because you will get pulled over again. And I said, thank you, Jesus. But here it is. At this stage in life, I'm not thinking of I didn't get a ticket. I'm thinking of I pulled off a lie. Because that is the day in which we live. Are y'all in the house? We have to deal with this. We have to deal with living in the reality that the system makes us all suspect. Woo! How do we fix it? You can't fix what you don't understand. So Amos gives us the answer. And then we're going to be out. Y'all better thank y'all for school, but we're going to get out real quick. Hallelujah. I'm almost to the end. Amos is the answer at the end. Amos gives us the answer. To those of us who belong to God, to those of us who are His, in the text, the nation is perverse. And guess why the nation is perverse? The nation is perverse because it hates the truth. In the text, you got to read it. You got to really read this whole chapter. Really the whole book. But the nation does not want to hear the truth. And anybody that does not hear or receive the truth is actually in bondage. Because the Bible says it is the truth that makes us free. Isn't it something then? Because then what that suggests, if the nation will not receive the truth, then really what it means is the oppressor is actually the oppressed. The sad and bitter reality is when you are walking around thinking you're an oppressor, but you are actually the oppressed because you will not hear and receive the truth, which makes you free. Are y'all in the house? So, they will not receive the truth. What is it in the text that sticks out to us? Well, the nation of Israel is enjoying peace. This northern kingdom is enjoying prosperity. But there is commotion outside of the chapel. Now, that's one thing that we need to look at, which is important. Because even though Amos is not necessarily, he's not a priest or anything like that. He's a minor prophet by way of the canon, but technically he's not even that. But here it is. Here it is. He started up commotion outside of the chapel. He must have a tent set up like we did. Because the commotion is outside of the chapel. Why? Because there are some people who still feel that because of their prosperity and because of their perceived peace, that they are still able to worship safely and comfortably, offering sacrifices to the Lord and thinking He's going to receive them. Understanding the root and the hatred and the evil of their heart. So Amos says, hold up. No need for me to go in there, because what y'all doing in there is not getting up there. So it's really no need for me to go in there. There's something wrong. You're comfortable in the nation, acting as if there's nothing wrong. You got to look at the text. He says you are at ease with taxes being raised on the poor and the middle class. That doesn't bother you. It doesn't bother you that there are a people who are disenfranchised. That doesn't bother you. It doesn't bother you that people are victims of excessive and deadly force. That doesn't bother you. It, it, the cause of this unfair and unethical treatment. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? But so much so that you tell the police, don't worry about them bumping their heads, just throw them in there. Y'all are not hearing what I'm saying. He says, you don't care about things that you should care about. And so as a result of that, judgment is coming to the house. Here's Amos coming with a word to save the nation. He says, with all that's going on, with all of the disenfranchisement, with all of the hatred, with all of the evil, with all of the racism, with all of the prejudice, there is still a God who is able to restore you to the place you once were, but you don't want to hear it. Because in your mind, great again is just you again. And God is never in the business of making great again exclusive. Even in creation, he said, and that's good. Hello. Maybe you're missing it because you're trying to skip good and get to great. But you never mastered good. Are y'all seeing where I'm going? The Lord said, and that's good. He created man and female, created him, and he said, that's good. And so you're trying to make it great. You want to be great again, but your concept of great is still perverted. He says, but those who belong to God. He says, let justice roll down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream. Here it is. You are a nation that turned from God. You claim him, but you don't cling to him. Which means you use scripture to justify your cause. Oh, y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying. But your heart is far from me. Y'all know the word, don't you? You praise me with your lips. But your heart is far from God. You have a zeal, but it's not unto knowledge. Oh, I wish you would help me just get out of here in a few minutes. So he says there's a problem and you don't even realize it because you must cling to him. And Amos says those who worship God are not working to be like God. You are worshiping and doing it in the name of God. But you're not living for God. What a shame it is when you do things in the name of God. But you're not living for God. And use scripture to justify your injustice. Never use it to worship God. We are a blessed nation, but our character does not match it. We are not as good as we are blessed, and not as humble as we are rewarded. And our character and our ascension are not traveling at the same rate. Because as you go higher, you ought to also go lower. As God takes you up, you ought to go down. But pride fills the hearts of those who march across this country in defense of something that represents institutionalized slavery. Pride fills the hearts of those who think that just because of the color of their skin, they have a privilege that's entitled them. Pride fills the hearts of those who have no problem treating someone else worse than they would desire to be treated themselves. Pride fills the heart, and you do know the Bible says that pride goeth before a fall. And so here it is, justice is a virtue that you've got to aspire, and it's a situation that I have to fight against my human tendencies when there is an injustice served. Let me say that again so that you don't miss that. I said I have to fight against my human tendencies when there is an injustice served. I will not lie and act as if, Sister Lee, I was not angered when I first saw what was going on in Charlottesville. With my sanctified, God called, God anointed, God appointed self, I was mad. I was angry. But then, and this probably makes no sense to some, but then I had pity. I had pity on a group of scared and confused and ignorant At first I said, this don't even make no sense. In 2017, but I knew it, you know, I ain't surprised, but I know. And I said, I had a whole lot of stuff. But then I said, man, when all your life you've been taught to believe that you are superior, and then something or someone comes and challenges what you have built your entire life on, it's got to be disheartening. It's got to be crushing. And my pity, of course, was not to validate any of the heinous crimes or hateful crimes that they did. But just looking at some of the footage and looking at some of the videos and looking at some of the rage and looking at some of the faces and just seeing how misguided and how misdirected they are. So what we've got to make sure in knowing that this is too big for us is that we don't allow our human tendencies to try to make us think that we can do it by ourselves. Because human tendency kicks in, and human tendency says, hate all white people. Come on. I was in Applebee's the other night after revival. And saw some white people sitting in the bar, long beards. And my human tendency said, watch them because they KKK. Now, I didn't know that for sure. I didn't know that for certain. But because of the climate of the day, and not because of my human tendency based on my contextual perception, everybody not black becomes suspect to me. Are y'all in the house? And so if we want God to do a work, we've got to make sure that we don't let our human tendencies get in the way. So it's not just on them, it's also on us. Tendencies, you have to fight. You have to fight when you've been disrespected. I don't care how holy you are. Something in you, you have to keep down. How can we get there? Amos says those who are worshiping God are not like God. How can we get there? How do we do it? It's too big for us. Not only do we have white supremacists and neo-Nazis and KKK members, but please do not forget North Korea. Please do not forget Syria. Please do not forget Russia. Please do not forget ISIS. Hello, are y'all in the house? See, this is much larger than just white supremacy. But there are other issues on the table that have somehow gotten pushed aside by this one thing that we know has existed since the beginning of our time here. This didn't just start, but it's a great time for us to focus on it so that we don't focus on the riffraff in the White House. It's too big for us. And the bad part of it is because some of it is happening because of the disrespect for God. For the founders of this nation built the nation on a lie and just justice for a few. And so that's why the Lord says you gotta let justice. If you want to be spared from the day of the Lord, you got to let justice roll down like waters. If you want to be preserved, if you want to be redeemed, you've got to let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. You've got to understand that this is too big for you. But the God you serve is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above anything you can ask or think, according to the power that works in you. God has the power to elevate you above your enemies, give you strength in your weaknesses, open closed doors, and give you what you need in the moment. Granddaddy says it is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, he will do for you. You cannot fear man, because the closer you get to God, the more strength you have to stand against man. And so Amos is not considered a prophet, but he had a word from the Lord, and he stood body against a nation that had disregarded God and his word and came with a message of explanation, accusation, lamentation, restoration, and then celebration. Let me say it again. He came with a the word of explanation, accusation, lamentation, hello somebody, restoration, and then celebration. What do you mean, my brother and sister? Here it is. Here's the explanation. He explained that God would send judgment because you have not surrendered to him. He asked, he said, are you not his chosen people? Weren't you given a privilege and a responsibility? Not a responsibility of just liberty and justice for all, but a responsibility that stemmed earlier than that, and that is to love your neighbor as yourself. That is, that we shall know them by how they love one another. You have a responsibility, and if a lion roars, he has prey, and if a bird is in a cage, it will sit, and if the trumpet sounds, it means that danger is near. The prophet is preaching, then God must have sent him. And Amos said that the Assyrians are coming to destroy the nation, and the services at Bethel will no longer be held because you have turned away from God. That's where this evil comes from. That's where this hatred comes from. Whenever you turn from God, you allow your heart to be vulnerable and made to stone. Whenever you turn from God and you deny his principles and his precepts, when you deny his word and his will, you are then vulnerable to the prey, and you are vulnerable to the enemy for him to come in and make you and cause you now not to be able to follow, even when you want to. And so here it is. He warns them and says that as a result of you who think that you're invincible and think that you're untouchable and think that your privilege puts you in positions so that you are no longer a threat or threatened, he says that there will be a nation that comes in and destroys you. Then he gives them an accusation. He names the sins. He calls them fat cows of Bethany. He calls out the sins. There's a sins, but the nation would not repent. Now, I like Amos because he does way more than our leader. He is not afraid to call what he sees what it is. He's not afraid to call a spade a spade. And my brothers and sisters, you've got to be like Amos. You've got to be able to name it. You've got to be able to call it out and not be afraid of the ramifications. You've got to be able to address it and not be afraid of any impeding danger. You've got to be able to say it, speak it, and not feel as if your life is in danger. I'm willing to say whatever I have to say, and I'll lay my life down on the line, because if God be for me, he's more than the world against me. He brings out the sins. He names them. He talks about the taxes. He talks about all the abhorrent things that they do, and he says, I will no longer use natural calamity. He says, I will come myself. That's what the Lord says. No longer will I use hurricanes. I'm coming myself. I'm not going to use a twister. I'm not going to use a flood. I'm not going to use fire. He says, I'm coming myself. And you think it's going to be a great day. You think it's going to be wonderful for you who are privileged, and you who have been privy to this information but didn't do anything about it. No, when I come, I'm coming with a sword in my hand. He says, I'm coming myself. And so what does he do? Amos weeps. Lamentation. He weeps because 90% of the people will die. But there is a remnant. He says, I know some people will be casualties of the situation, but there's always a remnant. Those who have not bowed down to the traditions and customs of men, who have not bowed down to society that disrespects God, but part of a nation that will obey, that worships in spirit and in truth, those who want relationship over ritual, repentance over self-righteousness. There are some who are saying God will deliver, but it will be justice. Just as the Lord sends the word, let justice roll down. Not judgment, but justice. Amos wants to see the nation blessed. And so he weeps over the sins of the people. And he says, this is too big for me, for us as a people. It's too big for us. No matter how many marches we organize, it's too big for us. You call Al Sharpton, call the NAACP, call the National Action Network, call the Rainbow Coalition, but it's still too can. If anybody can silence the accuser, he can. If anybody can restore peace, he can. If anybody can turn the nation around, God can. That's why I'm not worried. That's why I'm not afraid. Because God can make enemies footstools. And he can wipe out generations. So that after he gives his lamentation and after he gives his explanation, then he looks ahead. You can't stop where you are because you'll just get deeper in your feelings. If all you do is look around, you will miss what can take place in the future. And so that's what he does. He looks toward the future. He looks toward a day of restoration. He looks toward the day when God will bring men together. Just like Martin Luther King said, I have a dream. Little black girls and little white girl, little black boy and little white girl will be joining him, playing with each other. He looks ahead to the one person who's bigger than him. That's why David said of himself, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, for which cometh my help, because all of my help comes from the Lord. That's why Paul says, forgetting those things which are behind me and looking to the things which are ahead, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling. It is bigger than me, but it ain't bigger than him. And so Amos has a vision of a plumb line, and the Lord stands by the wall to see if it's straight, measuring Israel, to see if Israel would measure up. And the Bible says he saw summer fruit, naming the sins. But not only does he see sin, he also sees an altar. And even though we see sin on the outside and judgment that starts in the house, there is also an altar, a place of sacrifice, a place where communion can be achieved. Amos knows what we know. But chapter 9, he says, I know it looks bad. It's hard living where we are. I recognize the disrespected. I recognize the disenfranchised. I recognize the hatred and the evil. But Amos says in chapter 9, there is a promise of restoration. Somebody say restoration. After lamentation, you've got to push toward restoration. You can't get stuck in lamentation because then you'll get depressed. You can't stay in lamentation because you'll walk around bitter. You can't stay in lamentation because you'll walk around mad. You can't stay in lamentation because then you end up turning into that which you hate. You've got to move toward restoration. And that's why my situation has a celebration, because God is able to restore us and make his word good, and raise us in the midst of struggle, and raise us in the midst of oppression, and give us strength in the attack, and sound judgment in adverse situations, and peace in the storm, and hope in despair, and joy in sorrow, and hope for tomorrow, tears white. And if he was able to bring Harriet Tubman and Martin King and Sojourner Truth and Thurgood Marshall and Barack Obama through all that he brought them through, then he's able to work it in our favor, because it's bigger than me, but it's not bigger than God.
It's not bigger than God.
Hallelujah. Woo. Thank you, God.
If God be for us, who can be against us? March. Light your torches. Call me names. Do whatever you feel you need to do. But just know that God works for the underdog. He works for the disenfranchised. He works for those who have been oppressed. And he's in the business of setting captives free. It's too big for us, but it ain't too big for God. So brothers, sisters, we've got a responsibility to speak out. You cannot keep silent at a time like this. Amos could have chosen not to say a word, but because he understood his purpose in the moment, he understands that he has to proclaim. In the midst of these protests, somebody's got to proclaim. In the midst of the pain, Somebody's got to proclaim. And it's up to us who know God to proclaim, to profess, to pronounce that He is still able. I don't care how bad it looks. He's still able. Okay, how hard it is for us, Brother Anderson, He's still able. There may be casualties, but there's a remnant that will obey. Father, we thank You for Your word, and we thank You for the reminder that even with our history and with our present condition, You are still able. If our ancestors made it through and we are now the offspring of what they went through, then we can make it through this. God, as long as we walk with You and You with us, it may be too big for us individually, but it's not too big for You. Use us as mouthpieces. Help us to give an explanation. Maybe a lamentation. Help us to look toward restoration so that there can be celebration. Thank You for sustaining us. We haven't buckled under the weight of oppression. Thank You, Jesus. We still stand.
Thank You, Jesus.
When others try to knock us down, now cover us with Your blood. Hedge Your protection. In the name of Jesus. We love You. And it's in the mighty, matchless, and majestic name of Jesus the Christ we pray. Amen. And amen. Let's stand over the building. Thank God. It's too big for us, but it ain't too big for God.